Inspirational is a podcast, audio only episode, if you're into that sort of thing, where we talk about we being us two. There's nobody else here. Do you see anybody else here? No. Well, maybe this guy.
Yeah, there you go. Hey.
All right. So the two of us talk about our list of movie. I'm delirious.
Yeah.
The two of us talk about our list of movie blind spots.
We always get punchy in the last one.
I know, right? We're like, let's go eat. All right. AKA our list of shame, movies that we have not seen, that we are now watching, that we are ruminating on, pontificating. I don't know. I was trying to think of another word. I can't. I guess we're tired. But on Monday's episode, we tackled a movie that you'd seen before, but I've never seen, directed by David O. Russell and starring Bradley Cooper and Jennifer Lawrence. And you decided to pair that with another movie kind of along the same lines, at least the same people involved.
And Robert De Niro.
What is that movie that we're going to talk about today?
All right. Joy is the story of the title character who rose to become the founder and matriarch of a powerful family business dynasty. That's a hard thing to say. I got that from IMDb. And that's Joy.
It's a standard handle, 53 inches. The sleeve connects to the mop head.
Now this is where it gets complicated.
There's a clip that connects the sleeve to the, I don't even know what to call it, the cup, which is connected to the mop head. So when you pull up on the sleeve, the mop head stretches so you can wring it without ever touching it with your hands.
The only thing we see is these crayon drawings. We can't make heads or tails.
We don't know what it is.
So the mop doesn't hang loose like hair, like a string?
It hangs, but not on loose open ends like hair. It's one continuous loop.
I don't get it. What's he doing here?
He is the father of our children and my friend, and he looks out for me.
Joy came out in 2015. It was written, the script initially was written by Annie Mumolo, and I think it was written based off the real life person Joy Mangiano, I think her name is, or Manganiello. I don't have her last name.
Mango.
A real person, the person who invented the Miracle Mop, maybe? I don't know. But David O. Russell got that script and changed it and manipulated it. So it's a little bit different.
This won't do at all.
So it's he has writing credit along with Annie Mumolo, and he also directed it. David O. Russell, like we talked about, is directed and written a lot of movies. Three King, The Fighters, Silver Linings Playbook, American Hustle, Joy, coming out Amsterdam, I Heart Huckabees. He's been nominated for numerous Academy Awards. Hasn't won one yet. Annie Mumolo, we've done both of her movies she has written on, or all three now, a movie she's written on this podcast, on the show. She wrote Bridesmaids, and she wrote Barb and Star Go to Vista Del Mar, which we both.
And she's in Barb and Star Go to Vista Del Mar, along with Kristen Wiig.
Joy, like Andy said, stars Jennifer Lawrence as the titular character Joy. We have Robert De Niro as her father Rudy. We have Bradley Cooper as Neil Walker. I would think the trailer and the poster would make you think he has a bigger role in the movie than he actually does.
I did think he had a bigger role. Yeah.
Not a huge role, but no. He adds a little spice. It's kind of like him in Licorice Pizza a little bit, just kind of adding that coop to the movie.
Injection of coop. You got it.
We have Edgar Ramirez as Tony, who I think is awesome in this movie. Diane Ladd as Mimi. Virginia Madison as Terry. Isabella Rossellini as Trudy. Dasha Polance as Jackie. And Elizabeth Rome as Peggy, Joy's half-sister, who doesn't really exist in real life.
Oh, really?
Yeah. This is one of the characters you created.
I didn't read about her real life.
Without going into my full thoughts quite yet, I do wish this movie separated itself from the real life person a little bit more, like maybe changed her name, maybe changed the invention a little bit. I found that a little, I don't know a lot about the real life person, but just knowing that it's like an uncanny valley thing for me. It's so close, but not for me. So that I wish that was a little different, but we're not going to talk about my thoughts quite yet. We're going to ask Andy. Andy, this came out, 2015. Why did Joy not spark joy when you saw the trailer?
No.
Why did you not see it?
I don't know.
Dark Ages again.
Yeah, just like with Silver Linings Playbook, I mean, it just didn't appeal to me.
I agree with that.
I remember the previews for it and stuff. And, you know, obviously I'm aware of who David Russell is. I've seen most of his movies, but I don't know if this movie's for me.
Yep.
I'm not sure who this movie is targeted for, but I don't think it's this guy.
And I think the trailer was also very poor, in my opinion. Yes.
Yeah, I don't even remember the trailer. I just remember, like, I was like, yeah, that's not, it doesn't look really like my cup of tea. I don't know. But, yeah, so I didn't know a lot about, I did vaguely know that it was based on, like, a real life person whose name is also Joy. And I don't think I even knew what the invention was going into watching this movie. I just knew she was, like, an inventor. And, yes, I thought Bradley Cooper had like a huge role in it, just like he did in Silver Lines. I thought it was like, you know, they're basically trying to get together again.
Same
in
here.
This movie. So I was curious going into it to see how, because I like Silver Lines Playbook despite the ending. I was curious to see how well it would stack up against the Silver Lines Playbook movie. So to see him in a much smaller role was a little bit interesting or whatever. But I would say overall, I thought it was okay. I would watch Silver Linings Playbook again. I don't think I would watch Joy again. I didn't really dislike it. But once again, I'm not really sure who this movie's for. I mean, it tells an interesting story about, you know, it's to me, it's like, oh, you know, it's about perseverance and it's about like following your dreams and all that stuff, which is, you know, all those are great things. And, you know, it's a good message, whatever, although, you know, for most of us, we follow our dreams and we just get crushed like a bug underneath somebody's big, heavy boot. Sure. And, well, anyway. I think what makes this movie really watchable is the performances.
Yeah.
I think Jennifer Lawrence, once again, is really, really solid. And I don't know if people think that maybe this role is too similar or if people think that she's too similar to the Silver Linings Playbook. I think there are some similarities in their tough-mindedness, but I do see them as very distinct characters. Yes. It's like, I don't think she's like a one-trick pony. Like, oh, she's just going to play these same kind of roles or whatever. I liked her character in this. I mean, again, she's no nonsense like she is in Silver Linings Playbook. And I think she's just a talented actress. I think she's really good. And I can see, as I said last episode, I can see why she gets this critical acclaim. I think she's good. I think Bradley Cooper, despite the fact that he doesn't have near as much screen time in this movie as he does in Silver Linings Playbook, is also very good. And I completely agree with you. I think Edgar Ramirez is really great as her divorce, her ex-husband. But who's her best friend, basically?
I want to see him. Confidant. I want to see him in more things. I think he's magnetic in this movie.
Yeah,
especially when she like has a flashback to him like singing at the party and stuff. It's just like, what is this guy doing?
Yeah,
why am I not seeing him in more things?
Yeah, he's really good.
Through my head.
I agree. He's really, really good. I mean, I think the performances are good. Virginia Madsen has a smaller role as Jennifer Lawrence's mom, but she's good. Diane Ladd is the grandmother and all this stuff. So I think the performances elevate the material. Not to say the material is bad, but to me, this is just, it's an odd movie. And not odd in the sense that it's like weird or quirky, because compared to Silver Linings Playbook, this isn't really quirky at all. Yeah. I mean, it's a more straightforward story, again, about a lady who, you know, she's a mother, she's got kids, she's divorced, her husband's a deadbeat, although he's a cool character or whatever, but he's a deadbeat. Her sister's, like, jealous of her and all these things going on, and she just wants to provide for her family, have a better life, and she's got this dream of making this miracle mop. It's just a strange movie to make. I don't know why. I kept thinking that the whole time. I would say again, I thought it was okay overall. I thought it was very watchable because of the people involved, but it's just not something like that's very super memorable to me. Where do you fall on it? Did it make you? I tell you, when I watched it, I thought, I need to mop the house more. I need to mop the floors more. But that's, no. Did it make you feel that way?
Buy a miracle mop.
I need to buy a miracle actually, mop. And a velvet hanger or whatever she has.
I looked up. I tried to find her QVC thing of her doing the miracle mop thing.
Oh, like the actual clip? Did she really do that in real life? Is that real?
She's really on QVC. I did not find the original one. I found some recent ones with her in it. But apparently she was really on QVC. So, hawking the miracle mop.
Interesting. Yeah, I didn't really look up like how much this was in common with real life. I guess I could have.
Well, but I have a whole paragraph about it.
Okay. But where'd you fall on the movie?
I So when this movie started, I was really not into it at all.
Yeah.
Because it had, like, I want to say it was, I keep on thinking it had the Cream song, I Feel Free or whatever, in the very beginning. Like, when it's, like, mm-hmm. like doing the introduction. And then it abruptly jumps into the score, and I'm just like, whoa, this is like, I think some of the musical drops are very, like, on the nose. It's like, mm-hmm. this is exactly what the character's feeling. Like, the character's childlike and feels free. And
yeah.
there's a couple other drops where it's like, okay, yeah, this is very on the nose. And then we get to the voiceover, which I'm just like, oh, this voiceover is not...
Dying lad.
It's not great.
This is the girl. This
yes.
She has dreams.
It just
sounds
terrible. And yeah. then we go weird. To, like, the soap opera part, and I'm just like, what am I getting myself mm-hmm. into? This movie's so weird.
Yeah.
But I really like this movie a whole lot.
Really?
Yes. For me, the performances just pull it out. I really found the story interesting, even with all the... I would drop the voiceover immediately. Like, if I could re-edit this movie, I would drop yeah. the voiceover. It doesn't add anything.
Yeah.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
And even I like the soap opera stuff a little bit, so I'd keep that. But I think that's not doing its favor. So even with all that stuff going against it, I just found the story really interesting and really captivating. And I found the characters interesting. And again, I thought Robert De Niro was fairly good. I don't think he shines as much as he does in Silver Linings Playbook. He's not the same kind of character, but I think he does a really good job. There's a shot in the beginning where you see a young version of him, and I'm like, this is better than The Irishman.
Yeah.
Like, he looks really good. And I was like, I want to know how they did that. That looked really good.
Right.
When she got her shot for the QVC, I wish that was explained a little bit more, because it seems kind of, like, random. Like, the guy's like, you know, Bradley Cooper's character, Neil Walker's like, okay, we're going to sell your mop, and then the guy does a terrible job. And then she drives up there, and she's like, no, 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 you're going to let me get on there
yeah.
and do the thing. And I'm like, I don't think that would happen in real life. I mean, it obviously,
yeah.
excuse me, did happen in real life, but I didn't buy very much.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I just liked, I liked her pathos, and I liked where the character was going. And I don't know. It was quirky, but it just worked. I don't know why. It worked so well, but I really like this better than Silver Linings Playbook.
Oh, and, not me.
And I'm like, I really wish I kind of... Well, I don't know if I would have liked it when it came out, but I'm really glad I watched it and liked it now, because I thought it was very interesting and very... I dig it.
Well, it opened on Christmas Day. It was David yeah. O. Russell's Christmas present to the world back in 2015.
And I just would have
been a
couple
magical
years,
Christmas.
Couple no, years too not. Late opening it.
Well, so regarding the needle drops, the music drops, I think you could kind of accuse Silver Linings Playbook of also having
yeah.
you know, some of that. But that, it didn't bother me in Silver Linings Playbook. I think it bothered me more in this movie,
yeah.
like kind of the needle drops. I was like, oh boy, another song,
yeah.
another classic song.
Well, he does
whatever.
That in American Hustle too, and it just feels like...
I'm not real high on American Hustle.
It feels like, honestly, it feels like a crutch. And we've talked about James Gunn and Super in the show, and I'm going to say this now. It feels like a crutch for James Gunn, too. Like, I feel like he's better than his movies constantly having needle drops. But I just feel like he did that with Guardians, and why not go with it?
Well, the people eat it up. They laugh
yeah,
it up.
Yeah, they love it. But for me, I'm just like, no, I don't like it.
Yeah. Yeah, I like Silver Linings Playbook a lot more than this. I think this is watchable, and I think the performances add a lot to it. But I'm definitely, this one's not getting another rotation in my house.
I would watch this again for sure.
Okay.
So I have this from IMDb. So this movie is not a biography of Joy
Mangano.
Annie Mumolo's original script was based on Mangano, who's an Italian American developer, inventor, and entrepreneur for inventions just as the Miracle Mop and the Huggable Hangers. She's a president of Ingenious Designs. But when David O. Russell came onto the project, he added many more supporting characters and interwove Manganiello's original biography with stories of other women changing themselves in their lives. And Russell basically admitted that he was in no hurry to meet Manganiello before making the film, because he wanted to make the movie his own way. So It's just
so it's like he didn't base it on her, but her name's Joy, and she made a miracle mom. That is weird.
It's very like Uncanny Valley, right?
I didn't realize that he was not trying to really make a biography about her, but he still made a biography about her.
I don't know much about her, but that's the gist I got.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like. Yeah.
So that's for me. It's like, why call it Joy? Just call it something else.
Yeah.
Or if you're gonna call it Joy, because maybe the name, it's about her finding Joy, right, or whatever. Then make it the invention something else.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Just change that. Make it where it's not so close to the real life person.
Right. Right? It's not exactly like the real life thing. Yeah.
Like the Today Show and places like that interviewed the real life person for this movie, even though the movie's not closely based on her. It's like, that's got to be a really weird thing where they're like, yeah, they use my story as a stepping stone, but most of the cast of characters you're going to meet, I had nothing. I don't know who they are. There's no one in real life they're akin to and stuff like that.
So tell us about Peggy. And she's like, there is no Peggy.
Yeah, yeah, pretty much. Yeah, yeah.
Who's that?
So that's for me, that's weird. This movie had one Oscar nomination as opposed to Silver Linings 5 or 6.
You could nominate it for 4 or 5 Oscars or just one.
Yep, that's right. You can. They decided to go with just the one. Yeah, and that was Jennifer Lawrence's nomination for Best Performance in an Actress in a Leading Role. And I agree. I'm with you. I think the two roles are drastically different, and I think she does more in this role.
She carries this movie.
Yeah, yeah.
That other movie, she's splitting time with Bradley Cooper. He's really the
star.
Star.
Yep.
Yeah.
I agree. So, anything you want to add about Joy?
Nope. Other than I need to mop my floors, as I said. It's 60% fresh on Rotten Tomatoes and 57% audience score.
Gotcha.
Not as high.
No,
I didn't find a Leonard Maltin review of it. So,
well, Leonard, call me up. I'll add Joy to your book. I'm going to give it 3 stars, and I'll write something nice. So just phone me, buddy. We can be friends if you want or not.
Please.
Okay. That was Joy. So on these Wednesday, that's what today is, episodes, we always like to we like to answer viewers' questions. And since we've done some deep dive into David O. Russell this week, we decided to look at his whole filmography and give you a little gist of what we think of each film and maybe talk about what our favorite movie is by David O. Russell. So the first movie I've seen him on his filmography is Spank the Monkey. Is that correct?
Spanking the Monkey, yep.
And I have never seen this. I've never heard of this until I saw it on IMDb. But you've seen it? You've heard of it?
I have seen it. So I do want to say, earlier I said he followed up Silver Linings Playbook with Joy. It's a complete lie. Looking at his, he had two movies in between there, American Hustle and Accidental Love, which he directed it as Stephen Green, as we were looking at earlier, which is weird. So, whoops, I don't know what I'm talking about. I saw Spanking the Monkey when it came out, like when it came out on video. I didn't see it in the theater or anything like that. But because it got a lot of buzz for such a small film at the time, and I watched it and I didn't like it at all. And it's not because of the subject matter, but the subject matter is very taboo.
Okay.
Should I say what the subject matter is?
Yeah.
It's about a guy who starts having sex with his mother.
Oh, there you go. That is very taboo.
Which, again, that's not what, made me dislike the movie. You know, it's a movie, right? I just didn't like it. I just thought it was overall is bad. And I don't like the star, Jeremy Davies, much at all.
I feel like David O. Russell's, a lot of his movies are about dysfunctional families.
Yeah,
I think that's his shtick.
Yeah, I agree.
And then so he followed that up with Flirting with Disaster. With Ben Stiller, looks like.
Yeah.
And Patricia Arquette. Have you've seen that?
I have seen that. Yeah, yeah. It's funny.
It's funny. Is it good?
It is good.
All right. Three Kings. I actually saw Three Kings in theater.
I think I did too.
With Mark Wahlberg, George Clooney, and Ice Cube. I did not care for Three Kings. I thought it was really weird. Has that weird, like, X-ray Mortal Kombat thing in it, if I remember correctly. Like, about a bullet wound, like, puncturing, like, the gallbladder or something like that and putting like bile into the body or whatever.
Don't remember.
I remember that. Then I Heart Huckabees. I remember having to shelve this movie at Blockbuster. Although the date seems off for when I probably worked at Blockbuster, so maybe that's not a complete memory, but I remember seeing this on the shelves of Blockbuster. I've not seen I Heart Huckabees. It sounded stupid. The name sounds stupid to me.
Yeah, I liked it. I've only seen it once, but I did like it. I like the quirkiness and the weirdness of it. And again, there's always the added bonus of watching the behind-the-scenes clips where Lily Tomlin and David O. Russell are screaming and yelling at each other. And especially, I think those clips are funny, but to me, the absolutely most hilarious clips are her sitting in a car with Dustin Hoffman and Isabelle Huppert and yelling at both of them and telling them, like, cursing them out pretty badly. That's hilarious.
And then we have The Fighter, which I feel like was the one that kind of made his name. Like, that one won 2 Oscars. Won a best performance for Christian Bale and Melissa Leo. I remember that being a big thing. I feel like it was nominated for like best picture and all that kind of stuff too. Although I don't see it exactly here on the old IMDb's. I need to revisit The Fighter. Honestly, I just feel like by the time I watched it, it was such a thing that I couldn't watch it objectively. I watched it and I was like, it's a, I don't get it. I don't get the buzz. Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah. I remember liking it, but I couldn't tell you much about it.
Yeah.
Honestly.
And then, with After the Fighter, we have Silver Linings Playbook. Watch Monday's episode to find that one. Then American Hustle, which you kind of alluded to a little bit earlier. It's just so, it kind of took a left turn in like Quirkville, and it's so weird and so quirky, American Hustle. I don't know if it fully works.
I don't remember a lot about it. I don't remember liking it all that much.
And then Joy, which we, or have you seen Accidental Love?
No. And
he didn't even put his name on it.
He's ashamed of it. He directed it at somebody else, so I don't know.
And then Joy, which we're talking about today. So that's kind of his filmography. Of all the movies we listed, which one is your favorite?
So I purposely downplayed it when we went over it, but Flirting with Disaster is a movie that I used to own on VHS, and now I don't know. I can't even remember if there's a Blu-ray release of it. If there is, you can be assured that I own it. But I do know for a fact I have it streaming because I have watched it streaming within the last few years. I've seen that movie probably 10 times. I love Flirting with Disaster.
Oh, really?
I think Flirting with Disaster is his best movie by far.
Interesting.
And it's hilarious. I used to show that movie to people in the past. And this was before, you know, David O. Russell was really well known. But I heard about that movie somewhere. Maybe I just saw it on the shelf. You know, the VHS on the shelf, but I rented it and loved it, and I've loved it ever since. I love that movie.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. Very cool.
So now I can reveal my true feelings about Flirting with Disaster.
You lied to us, but then you eventually told us the truth.
That's right. That's right. That's what we do. That's what we do. What about you? What's your favorite out of his list?
Honestly, it's Joy.
Okay.
It
sparked major joy with you.
It sparked major joy. I think Joy is, maybe it's recency bias, but of the movies I've seen of his, and I've seen Silver Linings a whole lot, I think I like Joy a lot more.
I was going to say another 10 viewings of Silver Linings Playbook. Maybe you'll really like it.
Yeah,
it'll
really break through.
And you'll even like the ending. You'll love the ending.
Yeah, probably.
Yeah, maybe.
But for me, it's Joy. I like Joy a whole lot. It's weird and quirky, and maybe you're asking during the review who's the audience for Joy.
Yeah,
and
I was like, "Who's the weirdo that would like Joy?" And he's like, "I, me."
Yeah, it's the weirdo sitting next to you all along.
Yeah,
it's always the weirdo next to you.
No, that's cool though. And again, we say this all the time, but that's one of the cool things I like about doing this show with you is that we find movies like I really like Silver Linings Playbook.
Yeah.
That's a movie that I'm definitely probably going to watch again in the future. And you find movies like Joy, you're definitely going to watch it again in the future. Yeah. So. Very cool. We discover new favorites.
That's right.
On this show.
All right.
And new movies that we hate.
Yes. We're looking at you. We're looking at you. Find me guilty.
Find me guilty.
And her.
And meatballs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a big list.
Are you ready for the summer?
Okay.
You know who's not ready for the summer? The people that want this podcast in right now. That was our favorite and our ideas of David O. Russell movies. Leave a comment down below. Let Andy know that you also love Flirting with Disaster. You guys can start a community, maybe a subreddit. I don't know. Maybe, is that what the cool kids are doing?
I think so.
Do that. That'd be cool to know. Or let us know what your other favorite David Russell movie is. Maybe we need to check out The Fighter again and see Christian Bale all coked out, heroin out, punching in the streets.
Yeah.
Punching for his Academy Award, all that kind of stuff. Let us know. Leave a comment down below if you're watching us on YouTube. Please like, subscribe, share, do all the social media stuff with the episode. We really do appreciate it. It really does help. We answer viewer questions like we did earlier that are sent to us to our email address, realshame@gmail.com, or if you left a comment down below, we grab those and we add it to the coffers that we store all the questions in, because that's what you do. And stay tuned next week as we watch the movies from my list of shame, and we'll see you soon, guys. Have a good one. Thank you.